let faith rise. In spite of what I see, Lord, I believe. But help my unbelief, I choose to trust you. No matter what I feel, let faith arise. Let faith arise. For my champion's not dead, he is alive. Oh, and he already knows my every need. Surely he will come and rescue me.
Good evening, church. My name is Joanna, and I'm on staff here at Christian Fellowship Church. And we just want to say that we miss seeing your faces. We hope that you're all doing well. We're thinking of you and praying for you often. As we approach this Easter weekend and we're in what we would call Easter season, Holy Week right now, I would like to just share something that God put on my heart, and I hope and pray that it speaks to you wherever this video finds you today, probably in your home. I believe that God can transform your life, even though we're not able to gather together in a church building. I'm so thankful that God doesn't he's not limited to a church building. He's not limited to a place. And so I pray that even as I just read the Bible, as I read the Word of God, that something penetrates your heart today and that God actually transforms your life and that you feel His love and His comfort wherever you are today. And so I would like to read a few verses from Genesis chapter 2. We're going to read verses 7 to 9 and then verses 15 to 17. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And then we'll go down to verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." Most of us probably know that the story goes on to say that Adam and his partner Eve do eat from the tree, the one tree that God told them not to eat from. You know, God said, "You can have all the trees here," and they were all pleasing to the eye, pleasing for food, pleasing to taste. And yet Adam and Eve disobey God and they do eat from that one tree. God even warned them that there would be dire consequences, that if they did this, it would lead to death. Why is it that so often we know we're not supposed to do things or that we shouldn't do things, and if we do, there'll be consequences, yet we choose to do them anyways? Maybe I'm the only one guilty of this, but I think in many ways we are all guilty of living for the moment, living to please our flesh, and we often forget that our choices and our decisions will have consequences that echo into eternity. No temporary pleasure is worth sacrificing your relationship with God. And that's so incredible that we can even have a relationship with the Creator of the universe, that He wants to know us and be close to us. And yet so often we make decisions cause a divide there, to cause there to be a break or division between us and God, just like Adam and Eve did. When Adam and Eve ate from this tree that they were told not to, they didn't instantly die physically, but they did die spiritually. They damaged their relationship with God, and all of a sudden sin came into the picture. And sin is what separates us from God. You know, if God didn't judge sin, if He just shrugged His shoulders at sin, I don't think any of us would like that God. I don't think any of us would want to serve a God like that, who didn't care about evil actions or evil things that happened in the world and sin that people committed. I don't think we would like that God. He wouldn't be a God worth serving. And the next time that God shows up in this garden after Adam and Eve sin, the Bible says that they actually hide from Him, and they're scared when they hear God coming to them in the cool of the day. They feel shame and embarrassment. And if you've ever messed up or done something wrong, done something you knew you shouldn't do, whether that be something that you knew God didn't want you to do or your parents didn't want you to do, there's this sense of shame. And that's what Adam and Eve were experiencing. Unfortunately, this garden did not become all that it was intended to be, and it ended up producing death and decay. for Adam and Eve, and for all of humanity that would follow. But thankfully, God didn't just throw in the towel. He didn't say, good luck figuring this one out. The Bible actually says that God comes looking for Adam and Eve when they're in the garden. I mean, he's God. He obviously knew what they did. He knew that they messed up and that they disobeyed, and yet he still comes to them. And I'm so thankful that the instant we mess up, even today, when you and I mess up, God doesn't run from us. He runs to us. And in this story in the Garden of Eden, when all of a sudden there's this great divide, sin causes this great divide between us as humans and God, God actually has a plan in motion. God already has something in place, and he's actually making a way to us to have a restored relationship with us. And so his plan goes into motion in that moment. I believe that God is fighting for us, and he loves us so much. No matter what you do, it's not strong enough or great enough to keep God's love from you unless you let it. And so we're going to move on. We're going to read from Matthew chapter 26 now. And this is thousands of years later when Jesus is on the scene. And this is in those days leading up to Jesus' death and resurrection. So Holy Week, as we said. And we're going to pick it up in verse 36, which is right after Jesus and his disciples have just shared the Last Supper together. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him. And he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." In this scene, we find ourselves in another garden, a different garden. And yet again, we see a man facing temptation, but not just any man. This is Jesus. This is God. He's fully man and he's fully God. It's mind-blowing. Jesus is often referred to as the second Adam or the last Adam. The first Adam that we see in Genesis brought sin and death into the world. But the last Adam, Jesus, put an end to sin and death once and for all. In this garden, we see the humanity of Jesus as he struggles with the great anguish over what is to come. He knows that very soon he's going to endure physical pain, as well as separation from the Father. And ultimately, he's going to be put to death and nailed to a cross for the sins of all mankind. Some translations say that Jesus was troubled, he was in distress, or that his soul felt exceedingly sorrowful. And when we're going through pain, whether that be physical, mental, spiritual, emotional, even relational, I believe that Jesus can actually relate to us, and he knows what you're going through. We don't serve a God who is distant or far off. We serve a God that actually chose to become like us, take on human flesh, come close to us, and endure the sorrow and just the brokenness of this world that we live in. In Genesis, we also see a tree that leads to sin and death. It represents disobedience to God. But when Jesus is crucified and nailed to that cross, we see a tree that represents life, and life more abundantly. And it's in this Garden of Gethsemane that we see Jesus surrender his will, surrender his life, and walk in perfect obedience to the Father. In this garden, we see him struggle. We see him tempted with fruit, so to speak, to live for the moment, to live according to his flesh, according to his feelings. But he doesn't. He walks in perfect obedience to the Father, and he comes out of the garden victorious. You might be thinking, well, how is he victorious if he then goes on to die? Well, Jesus willingly gave up his life for you and I because that's how much he loves us. And the best part is that he didn't stay dead. He rose again. And the amazing thing about Christianity and the God that we serve is that he's not just some person in history, some great man who did great things, but you know, that's in the past. He's not just someone who died and was buried. The God that we serve is actually alive today, and he is still working and doing miracles and transforming lives today. So incredible. This God, this Jesus, is still able to transform your life, whether you need that emotionally or relationally or physically. I believe that that can happen. Even in this moment, I'm gonna pray in just a few minutes. And I believe that even though we're going through technology right now and I'm not there in person, God is there. God's presence is there if you welcome him, and he can transform your life today. When one man, one garden, one tree brought sin and death into the world, God transforms the situation and he uses one man, Jesus, one tree, one garden to bring life. In Romans chapter 5, I'm going to read one more verse. It's verse 18. It says, yes, Adam's one sin brings condemnation for everyone, but Christ's one act of righteousness brings a right relationship with God and new life for everyone. In other words, because of Jesus, because of what he did for us on the cross, we can not only have a restored relationship with God, but we can actually have new life for the present time and also for the life to come, for eternity. We can know that our future and our hope is secure in Jesus. God is still in the transformational business. I know I needed it. In fact, I still need it today. I need it on a regular, ongoing basis. I need God to help me and strengthen me and change me and transform me. Where there's sickness, God can bring healing. Where there's chains, I believe that God can bring freedom. Where there is separation, God can bring unity. Where there's brokenness, God can bring wholeness. And so I'm going to pray for you again in just a moment and believe for this transformational power in your life. There's a song that came out recently that kind of inspired some of these thoughts I'm having today, and it's called Graves into Gardens. And the lyrics say, talking about God, it says, you turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. And I challenge you, if you're listening today and there's something getting in the way of your relationship with God, the one who knows you and loves you better than anyone else, don't let it. It's not worth it. Don't let something temporary, something that pleases the flesh, just a little sweet fruit, hold you back from the most important relationship that you could have. You might say, Joanna, well, it's not that easy. I can't just give this thing up. I can't just overcome this addiction. I can't just change my ways. And I hear you. I do. I may not fully understand, you know, what struggle you're going through, but I believe that Jesus does, and he's there. Jesus experienced full-blown temptation and struggles and the weakness that we all feel at some point in our lives as humans. Yet he never sinned. He overcame. He came out on top, and that is why Psalm 46:1 says, he is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. And again, you might be thinking, well, I'm not God, I'm not Jesus. Like, I'm not that strong. And I just want to say, you're right. Like, that's exactly the point. You're not strong enough. I'm not strong enough. We don't have enough self-will or determination to overcome sin and to fight off the enemy and to fight off those addictions and those things that are in our lives. But we don't have to depend on ourselves. That's the most amazing part. We have to depend on the power and presence of Jesus to bring transformation into our lives. A quote I heard some time ago, it says, God doesn't just make bad people good. He brings dead people to life. And if you need that today, if you need divine intervention in your life or in someone else's life for their physical well-being or their mental health or emotional health, whatever it is, I believe that God can do that today. So if you would just, wherever you are, agree with me in prayer. I'm going to lead us in prayer, but feel free to use your own words. If you're scrolling on your phone or doing other things, maybe just put those on pause for this one moment, and I believe that God can bring change into your life. God, we thank you so much for what you did for every single one of us on the cross. We thank you for this season, God, that we get to celebrate you dying for our sins, even though you didn't have to. God, you chose to come close to us. And we thank you so much that you didn't stay dead. You rose again and you are alive today, working in our lives and millions of people around the world. And right now, God, we just invite your presence to come into each place, into each home, each person. God, whoever's listening to this video, God, I know that my words can't do anything miraculous, but your presence can and your words can. And so, God, we pray right now for people who might be sick. God, we pray for healing to come to their bodies. God, we pray for those who are out on the front lines working while everything else is shut down. These essential workers are still out there in close interaction with people. And God, we just pray a protection over their lives. We just pray a supernatural hedge of protection. We pray the blood of Jesus to guard them from head to toe as they go out there and continue to do their work. God, we pray for those who are listening today and those who are struggling. God, I thank you that you can relate, and I pray that they would feel your comfort and your strength today. We pray for those who are lonely. God, we pray that they would feel you so close, that they would feel you wrap your loving arms around them. Just come near. God, just come near to each of us today. We pray for those who are addicted. God, we pray that chains would be broken, that desires would be changed in Jesus' name. God, we pray for that power right now in Jesus' name. We pray for those who are depressed. God, we pray that you would change thoughts, change desires, change emotions. God, we pray that you would transform our innermost being. And God, we pray for those who are just straight up unhappy and unsatisfied with life. They're looking for more. They're longing for more. God, I pray in this moment that they would open their hearts up to you and say, come into my life. I need you, God. I pray that this would just be an Easter to remember in Jesus' name. And I really do pray that, church, whether you come to our church or not, I pray that this season, this time, would not just be a time to remember because of all that we're going through with this pandemic, but that this would be a time that you never forget because you felt and experienced God's presence and his power in your life like never before. And I pray that you would be changed in Jesus' name. I'm going to play a few more worship videos if you choose to continue to stick with us and listen, and just invite God's presence to come to you, to come to your house, come to your room right now. Maybe you're even at work watching this. We just pray that God will come to you in this moment, and we can't wait until we get to see you again in person. Have a blessed day. Thank you.
You never stop. name is above. His name is above depression. His name is above loneliness. Oh, his name is above disease. His name is above cancer. His name is above every other name.
And there